Reversing insulin resistance is a hot topic, and for good reason, because it underlies so many different diseases. In a recent video, Dr. Boss, an internal medicine physician and ketogenic diet proponent, discussed three keys for reversing this dreaded insulin resistance. We'll go through the video, add some context and studies to the claims, and then walk away with some key points to implement. Sound good? Let's get into it.
Reversing insulin resistance takes these three rules. Number one, track insulin, not calories. You may have heard the rebuttal that your body does not count calories, and it's true, but it does not make you unaccountable. Instead of obsessing on calories in versus calories out, we need you to focus on how much insulin your body is producing. Your body needs just one equation to be true to put fat onto your body.
Let me interject here. We'll get to the equation later. The two main points brought up by Dr. Boss are one, that your body doesn't measure calories, and two, you should focus on insulin levels. Let's address them. She's absolutely right that your body has no way of measuring or keeping track of your calories because calories are simply a unit of energy, more specifically, heat. However, calories are a direct proxy for the use or potential use of very real molecules in all your cells called ATP, the main currency of your cells. So it's not like counting calories is a waste of time. It has direct utility. In fact, while this has little scientific value, I've been counting calories for 15 years to change my weight up and down as needed. Now, on the other hand, I like her point that it doesn't make you unaccountable if you decide to not count calories. It's absolutely true that no one has to count calories, but some form of measurement is probably prudent if you want to reach your goals, like reversing insulin resistance. To her point, you could measure insulin levels, but I think there's some context that needs to be applied there, which we'll get into.
Your body needs just one equation to be true to put fat onto your body. It needs to have an elevated insulin while consuming food. Unfortunately, insulin is very volatile and sends you back and forth to the lab several times before I know exactly what it's doing. We'll get to estimating your insulin here in a minute, but for now, I want to arm you with the knowledge of what makes insulin rise, causing you to store fat. The types of food matter. Carbs cause the highest spike in insulin, whereas protein causes a lesser spike and fat causes the lowest spike in insulin. So that means we're eating fat first and a lot of it. Don't look at the calorie count. Remember, when you're consuming high fat, that metabolism starts to hike up. Not only does it have the lowest production of insulin, but it's the best return on energy per bite. Eating fat has the lowest amount of insulin produced. And when you consume fat in a low insulin state, it really boosts the metabolism. Again, you need the insulin to store it as fat. Without that insulin, you get to use it as energy. And that's how metabolisms get boosted on a high-fat diet.
Okay, a few heavy-hitting points here, some of which I agree with and others I don't. For fat to be stored, insulin must be high. Well, there's a lot of truth to that, but there's also some reductionism going on. It's true that insulin does promote fat storage as well as primarily reduced fat release from the fat cells and stimulating fat production in fat cells. However, the question is it necessary, as in must it be high for us to gain body fat? While there's no denying insulin has a potent effect on increasing body fat, there are insulin-independent ways that cells can take up fat molecules, which is especially true when fat consumption is significantly increased. For example, in this study, the researchers measured the amount of fat taken up by the cells when not exposed to insulin and when exposed to insulin. As we can see by the data, the amount of fat taken up by the cells is on the vertical axis, and time passed is on the horizontal axis. The red squares are the insulin-stimulated cells. Clearly, they take up more fat. But that's the crux of the issue. The fact that I'm saying more fat indicates other non-insulin-stimulated condition also took up fat into the cells. In addition, fat molecules are believed to passively move across the cell membrane, completely eliminating the need for anything. And If fat concentrations are elevated in the blood from greater fat consumption, we now have two insulin-independent mechanisms for encouraging fat uptake by the fat cells. That isn't to mention some others. The point being, yes, insulin is extremely important, but it's incorrect to assume that it's the only factor. The next point brought up by Dr. Boz is that types of food matter that raise insulin, and she's spot on. In fact, she was generous enough to offer a scientific reference, so we can just lean on that. And we can see that data. Dr. Boz's illustration is perfect. We can clearly see the lipids, that's fat, only provide a mild rise in insulin. In addition, a high-fat diet increases metabolism, according to Dr. Boz. That really depends on which analysis that you look at, this one or this one. One describes zero effect of a high-fat diet compared against high-carbohydrate diets on metabolism. The other says a low-carbohydrate diet boosts metabolism compared to a high-carbohydrate diet. So, at the very least, there's some serious debate on that point when looking at human trials. The final point for this section is tied up in the first point. You need insulin to store fat, but without insulin, it gets used as energy. We've already discussed the first part of that, but the second part has some truth to it. When people are fed a higher fat diet compared to a lower fat, high carbohydrate diet, like in this study, their metabolism does switch to burn more fat for energy. We can see that here. The black bars represent measure of metabolism called a respiratory quotient. If it goes down, it indicates more fat use for energy. The HF1 and HF7 conditions there are the high fat groups, and relative to LF or low fat high carbohydrate group, there is an increase in fat utilization for energy, again, because the black bar is going down. One thing that's often left out of this scenario is the fact that while the body does switch to utilize more fat when on a high-fat diet, as we just saw, that doesn't necessarily make it better at fat loss, because you're also consuming an outsized amount more fat than normal, like a counterweight on the utilization of fat for energy. I mean, this has been shown over and over again, like in these studies, where a very low-carbohydrate ketogenic diet compared against a high-carbohydrate diet yielded the same fat loss. Yet, that shouldn't be possible considering that the ketogenic diet is the one with the strong insulin advantage. In the end, the takeaway here is that yes, insulin is a major player in fat gain, but it isn't the only one. There's serious debate if a high-fat diet actually increases metabolism. However, a high-fat diet is still an excellent way to lose body fat and reverse signs of insulin resistance, if done correctly. But there's more. Actually, before we go on, I'm going to be releasing an extended version of this video that goes into more on reversing insulin resistance, including my hierarchy of importance and some alternatives on the ones outlined here. The extended version is included with the Physionic Insiders, along with access to all my work. If you're so inclined, it's linked in the description box below. Okay, let's continue, and then we'll simplify everything for some simple takeaways.
Years of chronically elevated insulin will take years to reverse, so stay focused on the high fat. We'll shift focus later on in this story. I've done experiments where I've added a quarter cup of MCT, or medium chain triglycerides. And although I had added 500 calories to the day, I lost weight because of that boosted metabolism in the presence of the reduced insulin production. So eat the fat, keep those carbs low, under 20 grams per day.
Okay, so Dr. Boz takes an MCT, or a medium chain triglyceride supplement that she sells, and even takes enough to make up 500 calories, which is a lot. Even so, she lost weight. I think most health professionals would admit that a single day fluctuation in weight, well, that's pretty meaningless. However, assuming that Dr. Boz did this for a long time, maybe it could be explained by the research indicating a boost in metabolism from a high-fat diet. Although that research indicates more mild increases in metabolism. Still, while I'm not skeptical of her experience, it's hers and I have no say, I do find it hard to believe that a person can add 500 calories of anything on top of their usual diet on a regular basis and lose body fat. I've yet to see a study that shows consuming 500 calories over maintenance leads to fat loss, but there have been hundreds of fat loss studies. So we'll chalk this one up as I don't know and move on to an interesting concept brought up by Dr. Boss.
Number two. Don't eat after dark. The timing of those fat-based meals has a profound impact on your insulin production. Remember that even fat produces a little bit of insulin, and so does the consumption of protein, as well as waking up in the morning. That morning rise of cortisol, where your brain intuitively knows that the sun is rising, sends a stimulus to your liver, where the production of glucose enters your body. And this spike in glucose results in a spike in insulin if you're insulin resistant. We want to front load those meals earlier in the day. Put that consumption of food in the daylight hours. The closer to sunrise, the better. Eating after sunset has a higher cost to those with insulin resistance. The longer you get between your last bite of food and the time you go to bed, the better your insulin will be the next day.
She's referring to the dawn phenomenon, and she's absolutely right. There tends to be a higher cortisol, blood sugar, and insulin at the beginning of the day. It's also true that consuming your meals earlier in the day will reduce insulin levels later, and especially the next morning. That's often discussed in the context of intermittent fasting studies too. I'm not convinced that makes any difference, however, because there have been studies that maintain the same nutrition, but simply change the timing of that nutrition and indicate no differences in total daily insulin, as in the pancreas secretes the same total insulin. So if the overall goal is to avoid insulin, meal timing makes no difference. The caveat here is that the study that I referenced was in healthy individuals, but I would suspect the same is true for insulin-resistant individuals. And there's even a little bit of evidence out there for that. Although, there are some nuances to that discussion that I can cover in the future. Oh, also, none of the meals were high fat. So if you feel that makes a difference on the overall point, that may change your view. My educated guess is that it makes no difference on total insulin over a 24-hour period. I'll post an amendment if that turns out not to be accurate. One thing I can say in favor of meal timing is that spikes of insulin can be avoided by eating one's meals more evenly spread throughout the day, if that matters to you. Anyway, dawn phenomenon is real, but if total insulin is something that you're trying to reduce by front-loading your meals, what evidence exists does not corroborate that perspective, that I could find at least. Now, what about predicting your insulin levels through this equation that Dr. Boss mentioned early on?
And number three, we have to measure it if we want to change it. If we want these rules to stick, we must measure the metrics so we can study the improvements. Earlier, I said the measurement of insulin is messy, and indeed it is. It's very volatile. So the best proxy for insulin is to measure the two molecules that it controls the most, that being glucose and ketones. Measuring glucose and ketones at the same moment helps us use that metric in combination to predict what your insulin is. We call this the Dr. Boss ratio, a derivative of the GKI, or glucose ketone index. The Dr. Boss ratio uses the glucose divided by the ketones, and the lower the Dr. Boss ratio, the lower the insulin.
Dr. Boss introduces the glucose ketone index, or the Dr. Boss index, to measure or predict insulin levels without having to get your blood tested every day. This is a creative tool, and I really like her approach here. If you want to know your insulin levels without directly testing them, the higher your ketones and lower your glucose, the bet is great that your insulin levels are low. Like I said, this is a creative, clever, and really a great tip, especially for people who don't have the luxury of an at-home insulin test. Okay, that was a lot of back and forth across all of what was said. What's the takeaway here? The takeaway is that while I disagree with some of the finer points made by Dr. Boss, because I don't think that they stack up to the available evidence, none of that disagreement is with the overall idea that a high-fat diet can be an excellent method for reversing many signs of insulin resistance. It can provide fat loss, which improves insulin resistance, but it can also dramatically lower blood sugar and insulin levels independently of fat loss. I would likely encourage a person to focus on unsaturated forms of fat, and I would also add that other nutrition styles have been shown to also be effective at reversing insulin resistance, including high carbohydrate nutrition. But if you're focused on a high fat for any of several advantages that it offers, then it can be an excellent choice. I also don't agree that meal timing makes much of a difference in total insulin, but if you care about insulin spikes, it can make a difference there. Finally, the glucose ketone ratio is great. It's a quick method for estimating insulin levels without needing dedicated insulin test. In fact, I have other content that describes ways of reversing diabetes and general insulin resistance right here. I'll see you over there.